Good morning, everybody. I'd like to welcome you to our webinar spotlight. This webinar, we're spotlighting First Arriving and their dashboard technologies. My name is Bobby Warshell. I am the partner channel manager here at Emergency Reporting and deal with all of our partners in the space. Today we have Ross Hopkins, who's going to give us a demo of what the First Arriving product can do and show you some integration of how it works with Emergency Reporting as well. But he's also going to show basically everything that their product can do. With that, a little bit of housekeeping. We do have a couple people in the background monitoring questions. So if you do have one, please use the dashboard to put your question in the system. And we may answer it directly, or we may interrupt Ross and have him answer it on the screen. Either way, we expect we'll have quite a bit of little time at the end of the webinar, and we may actually be able to get to a spot where we can open up some of the microphones and actually talk directly. With that said, I'm going to hand it over to Ross. Ross, it is all yours, and we are ready to go.
Hello, everyone. Thanks, Bobby, for the kind introduction, and also to Emergency Reporting for arranging this webinar here. If I sound kind of funky, I am a little stressed here, so a little nervous, but we'll settle in. To all attendees here, thanks for taking time out of your busy day to hop on here and see what First Arriving has to offer, and also specifically with Emergency Reporting. I hope that you're all off to a great and healthy start to 2021. 2020 was definitely crazy, and I hope everybody is getting through it okay. I am just going to let the dashboards sample here run in the background for a little bit while I give you all a little bit of background on the product itself. The product started a few years ago with a fire department in just north of Indianapolis. I talked to them, and they stressed to me that they've got a number of different software integrations, maybe Emergency Reporting, and then they utilize another party for alerting, and they use another party for scheduling and this and that. So every morning when crews would come on shift, they would spend time sitting at a computer, hoping it was available in between runs, logging into multiple softwares just to see what is going on for the day. Maybe see what the staffing is like, who's riding on engine 81, things of that nature. And so we talked about a way to basically showcase important items that is necessary for crews when they come in the morning and also throughout the course of their shift. Those items we quickly found out definitely vary from department to department. Everybody's pain points are different. The different items that you want to show could be different from the department down the street, and that's perfectly fine. So we came up with First Arriving dashboards here, and we basically do integrate with a ton of different softwares out there. Of course, Emergency Reporting is a premier partner of ours. The partnership, as well as the deep integration level between both of our products, is phenomenal. As you're all aware of, within ER specifically, there is a ton of different modules. Everything from just seeing nature of calls to rosters to equipment out of service, hydrants out of service, things of that nature. Those are all individual modules, and we can show all of the modules that you want, or we can only show select few, maybe just the pain points that you're trying to solve within your organization, within your agency. So that's how the product really got started and got off the ground. Our dashboards are meant to solve three big items for everybody. One is internal communications, one is situational awareness, and last but not least is real-time alarms. As you have sat here listened to me, you probably see the screen rotate and show different types of content. all of the dashboards that we have are all going to vary. We don't have one that is the exact same, and that's perfectly fine. Like I said, everybody's got different pain points, different views, different way they want dashboards to look. First arriving, we will definitely customize those to your look and feel. You might have a different color scheme that you wanna go with. You might have a different way you wanna show the scheduling. Maybe you wanna have the list view versus block. We definitely customize everything. With that being said, I am now going to just kind of go through different items that we have done. We've picked a lot of different things that are fairly common out there. You might have all of these, you might just have select few. It's perfectly fine. traffic, road information. That's something that everybody needs to know, especially your drivers, right? People that are actually turning the wheel. They need to know at Main Street and Union, they're gonna be paving the road. Chances are, they say it's gonna be completed by February 1st, but we all know how road construction goes. They give you an estimated completion date, and they're going to go past that by about 3 weeks at minimum, I'm sure. real-time traffic. We do integrate with Esri directly. So you might have a marathon this coming Saturday, and it's going to show that a road is going to be closed or something like that, right? So if you do have to respond to an area, you're going to know ahead of time. If it's rush hour, you know, between 7 and 9 and 4 and 6, maybe that one intersection is more usual congested. So you might see a lot more red, just more situational awareness if you have to go that direction. Another big thing that probably 98% of our customers have is going to be scheduling in some way, shape, or form. Whether we just show the current day's schedule, maybe we show tomorrow's schedule, maybe we show the schedule for the next 3 days. If your department, for instance, is a on 24, off 48 rotation, it would be common to have a screen similar to this that's got 4 columns, for instance, and you show today's schedule and then the next 3. That way you're going to see who is or is not on shift when you come back. Also with schedule, if you have multiple departments, multiple stations, maybe we can arrange those just by unit, you know, who's riding on what unit. Or maybe if you've got station 1, 2, 3, we just segment those out and just show the day's roster so everybody knows where everybody's at if you have to go on a mutual call together. let's see. Turnout times is becoming increasingly popular, and I agree with it. It's very important, as you all know, for accreditation. You want to get out the door as quickly as possible, but you also want everybody to be held accountable. Everybody, all members of leadership have the ability of seeing turnout times per unit, per shift, per day. However, it might be a little cumbersome to go and get that data. And then once you get it, then you got to track down all the people that were on the shift on that unit that might have had issues that day. Our dashboards can integrate directly with ER on that, so we could actually show per unit, per station, per department how that unit is doing. So like for instance, 8 runs have happened. 6 of the times they've left in under a benchmark that you specify. Some agencies want to put 60% on there to really get people moving. Some people keep it a little more realistic at 100, 120 seconds. That's, again, completely up to you. Let's see, some more items from ER that I'll cover real quick. The roster section, this is how we have it set out right now. So we show their title, name, and if they're in or out. Are they on a 24-hour shift? Are they just doing a part-time shift? Are they just doing day? We've also got daily logs. Of course, everybody is familiar with that when they log into ER. You're going to see that right away. We can show that directly on the dashboards. Certifications, you can see Joe Smith and also Jane Rogers are a little behind on a couple certifications there. We can show those. For lack of a better phrase, it could be name shaming, right? That is a section that on your dashboards you ideally would want blank, right? Because that means everybody is actually doing their job and they're getting their trainings and their certifications up to date. Moving along, weather. Everybody needs to know what the weather is doing, of course. We can, by default, we always try to show observational data, and that's going to include current temperature, wind speed, direction, and some other fun things, humidity, dew point, all that stuff, you know, can play a factor, especially if you get a working fire. And then we can also show forecast of the next few days. I currently live here in Clearwater, Florida. So as of right now in the wintertime, we might have a 75 degree day. But then tomorrow, for instance, it's going to be 60. I have a cold front coming through. For everybody that's up north, I'm sorry I said that. also with weather, we do also provide a radar with current precipitation, so you can see where that rain is, or also in this case where that snow is, and is it going to hit you or not. We do have departments that have multiple radars. Maybe you want to see where the rain is if you're in Indiana. Maybe you want to see if there's rain over in Illinois versus just right on top of, say, your county or surrounding counties. Again, it's going to be subjective, completely up to you guys. also with weather, in the header, we always show the current time, the highs and lows in the 3-day forecast up there as well. So you're going to always know what's happening there. But dive into a little bit more detail on different units that you guys might have, or that you all have. Having that status of knowing if a unit is in service or out of service is, as you know, extremely beneficial. Another scenario that you might not have thought of is if you're on vacation and you come back and you realize, hey, where is ladder 81? And you can look up on the dashboards as it just rotates through, and you're going to notice that it's out of service at Smith's Body Shop, for instance. So it's going to eliminate a lot of the asking questions, asking around, digging through your phone to see if you got an email on it. Maybe you didn't get an email on it. Things like that is going to be good for situational awareness. If you need to grab a truck, you know that it's what the status of it is. Depending on the size of the department, some folks opt to only show units that are not available. Others, smaller, they might just list all of them. It's completely up to you. I personally like to have the different colors so you just know what's happening and go from there. Different scheduling softwares. For instance, here we've got CrewSense as an example. We've got today and tomorrow, and we've also got notes and announcements. There's another view here where we actually separated out the different stations, so you can, you know, really see who is where and also what they are writing. And so that's another way that we can lay out scheduling information for everybody here. In case we have some agencies either actually located at an airport, or if your first due is an airport area, we do integrate with FlightAware. And it's really great to be able to show what's inbound and outbound. If something were to happen, you know that there might be 5 airplanes that are scheduled to arrive, and that's usually that could be unusual. It might be a smaller regional airport. But anyway, you'll be able to see if there's, you know, scheduled on time or if they're running late and things of that nature. Twitter, social media, everybody could show Twitter sections as well as also Facebook. We do integrate with both of those social media platforms. And over here on the right, I really like is the NOC chart that we actually did with ER. I've got a full screen example of it that I'll show you after a bit. But it's really kind of neat to see. Everybody likes visual, and you'll be able to see that we've had 4 building fires. So it just really breaks down what you guys have done. Maybe we show it on a monthly basis. Maybe we show it on a yearly basis. Depending on your call volume is going to matter probably on how you want to show that type of data. Let's see.
Ross, real quick, a couple questions.
Sure.
The latest on the apparatus in and out of service, can you show mutual aid departments? I'm assuming yes, if the mutual aid agencies are listed inside of ER's apparatus, but if you had multiple accounts with multiple customers, can they be able to show each other's units on one screen?
That's a great question. Absolutely. In the case of emergency reporting, both agencies, utilize ER, and both of them are customers. We can definitely show your department as well as the neighboring one. That's perfect for situational awareness with mutual aid, especially in rural counties. And we can absolutely do that. We have done it in the past as well.
Couple others, when you're doing your mapping and showing traffic patterns, I know you can connect to like Google. Is there any other traffic systems that you can attach to as well?
There is, we have done Waze, W-A-Z-E. We have done that one, not a crazy deep integration yet, but nonetheless, we have done it. Esri is really big. We can definitely show Esri's there. Traffic cams is also possible. I thought I had a screen with it somewhere. But yeah, we definitely can show those. If there's a specific software that you're curious on, make sure to ping us about it, and we'll definitely dive into it for you.
And I've got 2 specifics when you talk about software. One was iSpy Fire. I'm assuming that is probably an alerting or en route type solution.
Correct. That is a it's another mobile alerting platform. We do integrate with iSpy Fire. We do have a section on their website. I'm glad you asked that, because there's a really nice feature with iSpy Fire, and that is pre-alerts. So we, for a department actually out on the West Coast, we were able to basically ping the dashboards when dispatch was receiving a call, and we actually show just on the header portion here where you see crew 3 and stuff, that hey, there's a call at 123 Main Street, but it's a pre-alert. So you don't know what units are assigned, you don't know any of that yet, but you just know that there's an incoming call. And as soon as units are actually dispatched and the tones go off in the stations, we'll show a full-blown integration of that alarm details, which I will go over here shortly.
And the last question right now is CAD systems. Can you pull CAD data? Specifically, the question, Spillman countywide for dispatching, are they able to see mutual aid departments through the CAD system?
Great question. Spillman, they've got, I think it's called Spillman Flex now. They were standalone, but acquired by Motorola, I believe. They do have what's called data exchange, and we can connect to that as long as the dispatch center does allow it. And within there, we'll be able to pull unit status of the units in the dispatch center that they work with. And then we can also utilize that for real-time alarms as well as pre-alerts.
That's it.
Perfect. Great questions. Keep those coming. And all right, let's move along here. Equipment and certifications. Just like, you know, what I mentioned earlier with unit status or unit maintenance, equipment maintenance, apparatus maintenance, you could have more detailed things, you know, SCBAs, another method for certificate tracking. Maybe you utilize ER, but there's certain types of information that you would like to put out in regards to equipment apparatus, that is in addition to what ER has, then we can utilize another environment to expand on that to increase the communication and awareness on it. That's completely, completely customizable. This particular screen here, we have actually achieved utilizing the Google Sheet environment. The price is right there. Obviously anybody can sign up for a Gmail account and you will have the opportunity to use Sheets and Slides. You'll see some more examples of that here in the next few minutes. If there's additional entries, you see the screens scrolling over here on the left under SCBAs. It might be choppy on your end. That's just due to lovely internet. And I'll move along. Videos. There's definitely some agents there that would love to show. Maybe a chief wants to do a message every morning or once a week, and you want to have a means to distribute that and not necessarily require a lot of action on personnel, meaning they don't have to go and log into a computer and then open up a YouTube playlist or something like that, right? We can actually integrate with YouTube videos as well as YouTube playlists. And there's a couple ways that this can be done. More often than not, I'll tell you all, is people like to have certain blocks of say 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes every day. And maybe even twice a day, where nothing will show except for the videos that are entered into that playlist or into the portal. This would be good for training sessions, especially in these crazy times of COVID. You might want to limit the amount of times that people at Station 82 go to Station 81s for training. Well, now just show the training videos, put them on your first arriving dashboards. Now nobody has to go anywhere. And also there's no action required by the users or the viewers, except for make sure you're at one of the screens within the station. There's no getting on a computer or logging in and doing any of that. It's just gonna show automatically, say 8 a.m. So that's an example there. We've done just quarter screens that you see here. We've also done three quarters of a screen, like you see here. And we've also done full screen. I would say more often than not, full screen is by far the favorite. Just seeing how a lot of folks have that integration because they just want people to focus on the video, because it could be training on a new piece of equipment. It could be an important message from leadership with COVID updates. The content can vary, but the principle is the same. It's information that you need to get sent out, and you want to make it as easy as possible and get to the biggest audience. Station news.
Yes. Real quick. Sure. I know you guys are designed around, you know, TV formats in the stations, but we have a question about, can any of this content be accessible via a mobile device or a tablet?
We are, as far as mobile, we are looking at tablets and being able to 100% fully support those. Mobile phones, not necessarily at the time, not ruling it out. That's just something that with the way that our dashboards look, it's going to be hard to squeeze into a small form factor. However, not ruling things out. I mean, 2021 is definitely has just started, right? So, and also in regards to that, there is a lot of native apps for a lot of softwares that are out there, and we don't necessarily want to take light away from all of those as well.
And last follow-up to that, is the format only available in landscape, or can it be done also in portrait mode as an option?
Another great question. As of now, we have only done landscape. As for portrait, that is actually one of the things on my list that I want to experiment with. Have we done it yet? No. Do I want to do it? And does First Arriving want to do it? Probably. I think it would be really neat. Coming from a digital signage background, simply turning the screen over is going to draw people's attention as well. So I do like the idea. Reach out to us after this call and let's maybe talk about it.
That's all. Keep going.
Okay. General news that you want to push across. Maybe you all utilize emergency reporting in the daily log section, or maybe just the events, but you want to be able to put more information, such as what you're seeing here. We can provide different tools utilizing maybe say Google Sheets, for instance. You're going to hear that a lot, especially when we talk to you all after this call with the one-on-ones. We do utilize Sheets a lot just because of the flexibility. And it also is easy for the user, and we can do a lot of stuff with it. In this particular instance, I like it because you have a dedicated section for just department news, but then you also have news for individual level. If you're a department that's got 10 different stations, you don't need to know that station 5 needs to fix the seal on the front door because a bunch of cold air and snow is blowing in. You guys don't care about that, but that individual station does. So that's type of information that can be pushed out on a station level. It also gives battalions and captains a little bit more ownership in the dashboard product themselves to help communicate with the people that call that station home. Fire Rescue 1, as you see on the other side there, is a very common RSS feed that we do show for a lot of people. If nothing else, we've heard that it strikes a lot of conversation among the different crews. Like, for instance here, did you see the Massachusetts town, what happened there? And then maybe it just strikes conversation, right? Just whatever the case may be, it's really just a conversation starter. And let's see, Target Solutions is another integration partner here. We can show data such as incomplete reports or incomplete assignments, courses that are coming up. And then we've also done their fleet tracking software. So you might want to see if a unit's in service, out of service, maybe the number of open work orders or overdue checklists. Again, it's a way to keep people accountable. If it's noon and the shift started at 7 and there's still checklists that are not complete, Why is that? Now you have a means of going to somebody and saying, hey, what's going on with this? It keeps things moving along. Different websites. This is an example that we did a lot last year. We put the Johns Hopkins COVID dashboard on. I'm sure everybody has seen it. Again, it was just a website that we can integrate into a piece of content on your dashboards. So it might be a homegrown thing, that solution that you have that you just want to be able to get out to everybody and have it as a piece of content with other things, or you know, just information like the COVID stuff. We've got even some departments will put county stuff on there that comes from this. So this is just another way of getting information out there without requiring action from personnel specifically. And calendars, I'm sure everybody here utilizes either emergency reportings calendar, a Google calendar, or a Microsoft Outlook calendar. And those are probably the three most common different ones out there. We do integrate with all of them, of course. Maybe you want to see a two-week view like you see here. Maybe you want to see a rolling two-week view. Maybe you want to see just the current date. We could do a lot of fun stuff there, including a month view if that's going to be more important to you. Again, there's a common theme here that you're seeing, and there's a lot of customization that we can do for agencies. Let's see, telestaff. Some users might utilize telestaff, so we can actually get that data as well. This particular one, we color coded based on the unit, so you can quickly see how many people are on different units and also see if they're a full shift. Are they a 24, 48 or a shift? Are they just an 8-hour shift? Are they just covering somebody for 4 hours? It's completely up to you.
Another question, Ross.
Let's hear it.
We use Google Calendar for our shift roster. Is there a way to show who is on duty and when? And when in a roster type view or only the calendar type layout? So how much of that data can you scrape out of a Google Sheets to, can you show it in different formats, not just a sheet view?
Yes, absolutely. This is an example that we could do with a Google Calendar for the roster. Actually, this is a really good example. So we got the different names. I should have paused this. That's my fault. And so we could do it that way. We can show just in list view. It really depends on how it, you would have to make sure that you are fairly consistent with how the entries are added into the calendar specifically. I don't need to go into a crazy amount of detail on it, but short answer is yes. And make sure to just ping us after this call, set up a one-on-one, and those are questions that we can definitely answer for you.
Any integration to Active 911?
Yes, absolutely. I was going to go through that here as soon as I got done with this ER stuff, but since it was asked, I will do it now.
One last question before we get there, still on the personnel. I'm assuming, and they also asked about e-dispatches as well as Active 911. It's e-dispatches is another product. But as part of that, I guess it's part of the Google Maps, the Google Sheets piece. Can you assign personnel to a unit by position, i.e. officer, driver, et cetera? I'm guessing they're more so about displaying it by officer type versus, because you're not going to be able to do any assignments there as part of staffing. You're just taking the feed from what's already done, but you could probably display it in different ways as far as by rank and that kind of thing.
Yeah, we can sort and filter a lot of different ways. It's really going to depend on how you have that calendar set up with those different quote events, because each name is an event in Google Calendar. So you would probably put Ross Hopkins, officer, and I don't know, Engine 81. I don't know. Something similar to that. And if you keep that same format, it would be really easy to do. And we can definitely do a lot of stuff with it.
And like I said, with the active 911, they also mentioned e-dispatches.
Perfect. There's definitely e-dispatches we don't have a direct integration with just yet. However, there is another way that we can solve that. Well, we could actually get the data directly from CAD in a similar fashion. So that's something that we can explore. Again, just ping us after the call, and we can talk about your specific use case and see how we can solve the alerting aspect piece of the puzzle for you.
Okay, thank you.
All right, since there's a couple questions there regarding alarms, let's say you're just looking through, you're just getting done with lunch, you're getting up from the table, and you're checking out the traffic events. All of a sudden, you start to hear tones go off. Your screens are going to automatically change into something similar to this. By default, we always try to show the nature of the call, the address, the units dispatched, and any notes that might come through. And we also can do some different things with Esri maps. We usually will show at least a map with a path. So you go from the station to the scene. You can also see how long it's going to take you. Maybe you're going 4 miles, maybe you're going 20 miles. It's going to be a good situational awareness piece. In addition to that, at the top right of the screen, you'll see a timer. It's a stopwatch, so you know exactly how long it's been since that call came through. And it's also another way to hold people accountable that are writing on a specific unit that was called. If three people have to write out, two people are in the truck at the 50-minute mark, and the last person's not in until a minute 50, then you can ask, hey, where were you? Let's go, type thing. We have different views for alarms, as you can see here. We always try to show the nature of the call, address, units, if there is any that come through, and then also details. This is the distance and approximate time. If you use active 911, for instance, I did hear that word from you, Bobby. They do have the ability of, you have the ability of uploading your hydrant locations there. We do get that information from Active 911 and their API. So we can use that to show the closest hydrants to the incident location. Definitely useful if you have to, hook a hose up, of course. Some other views, those two that I just showed, but then this particular one, we added a static street view image. And so you can see the building, where it is that you're at. You know, maybe 3533 77th Avenue rings a bell, but you can't put a picture to it. Why everybody is throwing on their turnout gear and getting ready to go. You've got dashboards scattered throughout the kitchen on the way to the apparatus bay. And then, of course, you have another one in the apparatus bay. So you could take a look at it, and now you don't have to get your phone out. You don't have to fumble through to find the correct app and things of that nature. It's just going to be shown visible on the screens for you. Let's see. So that was, and then here's another example that I showed earlier with the live call. Maybe you wanted to have a satellite image instead of just a regular map. And maybe that's going to be more beneficial to you guys. We could do that as well. And then we also have an alerting screen that has no map. There definitely is agencies that like to have this. This can be maybe some people would view it as a distraction to have a map, and they just want to, hey, you're going to Route 999, get in the car and go. Others opt to see that street view image, so you know if what house it is when you get to the cul-de-sac, or what side of the strip mall that you have to go to check out a smoke alarm, things of that nature. That's an example of there. That covers a lot of the different alarm views that we have. We do work with a couple different CAD softwares out there directly, and then we also work with Active 911, Ice Wi Fire, Rover will be shortly, and we can use this as an added benefit to your dashboards, because it now is not just the internal communications and situational awareness. It also is a means of providing people responding to calls more information that would have required them to either look at a computer really quick or get their phone out their pocket, open the app, see where it is. Well, now you got one hand tied up. You can't get your turnout gear on. This is a visual on a display in your face and not holding up any time, which should increase or improve your response times.
Ross, can you, in the case of Active 911, can you scrape the data and actually show who is responding? Like in the case of maybe a volunteer organization or a small career where they can actually place themselves in route and that kind of thing through the app. Can you actually display who is going to that call?
Great question. Yes, we can. Within Active 911, and that call comes through on your iPhone or Android phone, you have the ability of hitting unavailable or responding, or actually, I think you could even customize what those options are. And once a user hits that, it will come through the API directly to us, and we will broadcast that out. Unfortunately, I don't have a screenshot of that, I don't think. But please ping us after, and we will be able to show you some more and talk about that a little more in depth.
I do have one more question, and you may want to save this to the end. But it's a good question about your hardware technology that's actually being used for this. So the question was, can multiple screens run from one remote computer? And you're not actually running these boards from a computer. You're running them remotely through a device plugged into the screen. So maybe it's a good, either for the end of the conversation or maybe now, talk about what your technology is that you're actually using to do this.
As of now, we are utilizing Chromeboxes to power our application. Each Chromebox is attached to a monitor, and it is meant to run 24/7. Once order is placed, we do inventory them. Shipping is included, and it also includes an HDMI cable. So one box is meant to power one monitor. I see where that person is coming from, whoever asked that question, and it's not good practice to try to split that. You're going to end up losing signal. You're going to get a lot of delays. You could have issues with one display taking over, and more importantly, we also find that a lot of our customers would actually prefer to have different content on different screens. So maybe in the kitchen you want to have everything show that your organization wants to push out to everybody, but then on the other side of the kitchen or right down the hall somehow you only want to show scheduling data and get alarms, and then out in the apparatus bay you want to be able to just show equipment maintenance, fleet maintenance, unit status, and then also get real-time alarms. Maybe leadership only wants to see weather and turnout. You can't do that if you are trying to do multiple things within a department with one box.
Very good. Thank you.
Um, Let's see, I want to go over some other ER specific screens here that we have done so everybody here can see this. Equipment maintenance module, here's an example of that. Incomplete reports, daily log. Here is some of the same items. However, we added scheduling in there and we laid it out in quadrants instead of actual columns, if you will. So you might like this view better because you can get more information on it versus this one. The calendar we showed earlier, we could do like a rolling. I need to pause this. We can do like a rolling calendar. So maybe it's, you know, 3 weeks like you see here. Maybe we just do 1 week. Maybe we only show the current day. Here's another way that we did the calendar section from emergency reporting. Instead of an actual calendar view, we just actually separated out and did what we'll call a list view of the calendar events. So it's another way that you can see what's happening. Different classes, same thing. And here's an example where we segmented out open burn permits from emergency reporting, as well as hydrants out of service, and then apparatus out of service. So we separated those things out. So you can clearly see, one of the things I want to point out here real quick, this is a good use case, is utilize our dashboards to start organizing different types of information. You guys might find yourselves utilizing a Word doc or something like that for different types of things, or using the daily log to just show, to write down everything that is happening within your organization that you want everybody to know. I guess I'm saying don't do that. Emergency reporting is a great example of having separate modules for dedicated things. And our dashboards are no different. We can separate everything out. So as I come into your station and I'm in charge of dealing with the water department about hydrants, I don't want to go and look at maybe all equipment and apparatus out of service in one big list. I just want to see hydrants because that's what I'm focused on. Utilize our dashboards to segment out different types of data. It's going to be a lot easier for folks to find. It's going to keep them in the know easier. And at the end, it'll actually save time, and time is money. So there's that I wanted to get out. Same thing, apparatus maintenance, dedicated section. Equipment maintenance, dedicated section. Hydrants, dedicated. So now if you're only focused on the chainsaw, it's going to go in equipment and I don't have to look anywhere else. I mentioned earlier, I wanted to show the other NOC chart that we did. Here's an example of a customer. I think it just looks really cool. Again, it's visually appealing. It's going to provide a lot more information to all the crews so they can see what everybody is doing within the department. You might be a bigger department and you had no idea that you had actually responded to 20 calls for a power line down, for instance. So that's going to be a good awareness. Recent calls within emergency reporting, we can plot where the recent calls have been and show them on top of an Esri map. Another way that we did staffing, this would just be a current day, but we separated out by station. We sorted by position, and then we also put what unit they're on, and also their time, of course. Apparatus status, same scenario that we covered earlier. What I do like, this was actually fairly recent that we did. Bobby, I don't know if you've even seen it yet, but runs per person. So you, if you're a volunteer, you can really keep track of who all has responded to what. And if you're a career department, maybe it just so happens that, you know, station 89 C-shift, they're just consistently getting a heck of a lot more runs than A and B. So another way just to see, kind of keep tabs on everybody, go from there. Turnout times, like I mentioned earlier, is becoming increasingly popular, especially for accreditation purposes, and also just keeping tabs on how folks are doing. If you're showcasing this to everybody within your department, they're going to be like, hey, we need to make sure we're not the ones in 79% with shift B. Shift B sees that. Whenever they come on, they're going to be like, all right, we got to get going. What this does, and you can already imagine, is it's creating competition among the different crews, which is going to improve overall. Lost the screen. Which is going to improve. Where'd it go? There we go. Which is going to improve the responses. So we can do by shifts, we can do by units, however you see fit there. Incomplete reports. If somebody still needs to get one turned in, now you can put their name up there, say when it was, and also the incident number, so you don't have to go and hunt for it. Here's another example of daily log. Another example of scheduling. Why didn't I pause it? Another example of schedule. Then also last shift incidents. So you can see what units responded to what time it was, and what they went on. So that covers a heck of a lot of information from emergency reporting specifically there. So I wanted to point that out. Some other general operations with our dashboards. All of our dashboards will ship with this menu up here. So you can simply plug a wired or wireless USB mouse into that Chrome box. And then if you have a lot of sections and you quickly need to go to the schedule, then you can just click on it and go right to the schedule. It's going to allow you to have more information that scrolls through without interaction, but also provide the ability of getting information very quickly. Something else that is new is Zoom. Some users on here might utilize Zoom for conferencing, for training, things of that nature. You can click the menu, go right to Zoom, and this would allow all the stations that have got dashboards in to log in without purchasing extra equipment, to log in and view, have a lot of people huddled around a single computer monitor, which we all got to stay 6 feet apart. This is going to allow that. I've also seen people under the name, they'll just put Station 81, Station 82, Station 83. So now the organizer of that particular meeting knows which stations have logged in, and you can start that presentation. So that's a very new feature that we have, and that will come standard with everyone. If you use it, great. If you don't, that's okay as well. All of our sections will rotate on a set schedule that you choose. By default, we'll start around 60 seconds, but then you might find that weather doesn't need to be on for 60 seconds. It only needs to be on for 30, but your scheduling, you want it for 2 minutes. Again, completely customizable. You just let us know what you think is going to work the best. And more importantly, once you're up and running, we've got a great support staff that will be there quick to respond to your tickets and make those adjustments for you. And at the end of the day, this is going to become your central communication area. It's going to be around the coffee pot. It's going to be in the apparatus bay. It's going to be in offices of leadership. I think that about covers everything that I wanted to go over. I went crazy over time here. I want to allow time for more questions. And I thank you all for joining. So let's open it up to some more questions if there is any.
Perfect, Ross. Yeah, we got about 5 more minutes. I can unmute. So at this point, you should have the ability to take yourself off of mute if you got a question you want to ask. If it does not work, it should have. But if it doesn't work, feel free to add your question into the chat or into anything else. There we go. Try that now. So Jonathan's got a question. Is the webinar recorded? Yes. Automatically at a 24-hour mark after we close this, all registered attendees will receive a link to go back and look at it. And we will also be probably posting it up on ER's blog page, and First Arriving will probably do the same thing. Any other questions? Like I said, you can unmute yourself if you want to ask a question, or please just type it into the to the windows. Got one dealing with cost of the program. So there is kind of a, it deals with, and Ross can explain a little more, but it deals with how many integrations you're actually looking to do. The arrangement we have with First Arriving, we can actually put this on emergency reporting paper. So if you already have an emergency reporting account, we can resell the products. We can get you in touch with your sales rep. But we can also get you in touch directly with Ross and his team and walk through what that might look like for you. There is sort of a basic, a standard, and an enterprise tier. Each one gives you a different number of integrations to different products. So it really depends on what your need is for how many integrations and what it is you want to display and show.
Yeah, that's perfect. Just contact us and we can chat about the size of your department, what types of integrations you might be looking at, and go from there. We'll definitely work with you.
Any other questions? We've got just a couple more minutes. If there's no more questions, I do want to thank everybody for coming and watching this presentation today. I think it was fantastic. We had quite a bit. At one point, we had about 35 attendees. I know there was close to 100, if not more, registered. Great questions came out of the group of people. Ross, thank you. You did a fantastic job, no matter how nervous you thought you were. But beyond that, I do want to thank you for time. I know everybody's time is valuable, and I'm glad you came and spent a little bit of time with us to show this product.
Yes, absolutely. Thanks everybody for taking the time out and spending an hour with us. We hope to hear from each of you, and all continue to stay safe out there.
And with that, I will go ahead and shut this down. I don't see any more questions in the bank. I think we're good. So with that, I just want to say thank you once again, and we're going to go ahead and end the conference. And I appreciate it, everybody. Thank you for attending.
Thank you.